That's fine. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to yet another edition of Thumbprint Conversation. Tonight, we'll be in conversation with Mitra Phukan, author, columnist, and translator. So, I've sent an invite to Mitra Phukan to join the conversation. And so we had the Thumbprint Conversation is, we have started this series where we are discussing why women write. And we are trying to get in touch with Mitra Phukan, who will be in conversation, who will be talking about why she writes. So I've sent an invite, and while she joins us, I would like to narrate one story I had done in 2011 for a portal called The Hoot. It's basically about few women in Urdu media in Bihar. And yes, Mitra Phukan, did you get my invite? So, this story is about the female journalists in Urdu newspapers in Bihar. Yes, and I think we are having Mitra Phukan on board. Yes.
Indeed.
So, no answer. So, I had met them at a conference on women in media in Patna, in Bihar, the capital of Bihar. So, yeah, Mitra Phukan, I've sent you an invite. So meanwhile, while she joins us, let me tell you the story of these women reporters in the Urdu media in Bihar. So it was inspiring to see Nazia Naushad, the sub-editor with the Urdu Daily. Roznama Rashtriya Sahara, as she gears up to return to office after attending the conference. She wears her naqab or the burqa and is set to get on with her daily grind. And the first journalist in her family, Nazia had learned Urdu along with her formal education. Later, two of her sisters also followed her in her profession. Hailing from a village, Bagwar, Mira Bigha, in Jehanabad district of Bihar, she and her five sisters happened to be the only girls in the entire school. I think we are adding Mitra Phukan now. Hopefully, there are no technical glitches. So, she told me, my mother shocked everyone by only by boys.
Hi, finally.
Hello, Mitra Phukan.
Yeah, hi. Nice to be here.
Hi, finally we see each other.
Yeah.
So, I think we are connected now. Switch off the fan.
Yeah, I'm connected.
Yeah. So I was just telling a story which I did in 2011. And so this is about, So this lady called Nazia Naushad, she told me how she's the only woman sub-reporter of an Urdu daily in Bihar. And she takes care of editing of the page which deals with the news of Magad area. So then apart from her daily editing chore, she also writes features on empowerment of women and is compiling her writings in a book form, which she has aptly titled Aurat Jise Kehte Hai. So she has completed her PG diploma in journalism from Patna University and now plans to go for higher education. Is the voice echoing?
No, you're absolutely clear. I can hear you absolutely.
Okay, fine. So there are 9 Urdu newspapers in Bihar and there are only 2 women reporters. And Nazia Naushad was on the editorial desk. Then a senior journalist Nivedita Jha told me that it is an uphill task for a woman or for a Muslim woman or a Dalit woman to break the established norms and enter a male-dominated profession. The scene is deplorable in districts and Mofussil towns. And there are several reasons. The nexus between politicians and media houses, lack of security, inadequate salary, infrastructural lacunae, such as lack of electricity and computers. All these work against the interests of women. And I had met another very dabang reporter, Reshma Aftab, a reporter with Roznama Rashtriya Sahara. She covers all the beats in Patna City subdivision, which is a sensitive area. And she covers everything from murders, kidnappings, dowry deaths, and politics to investigative stories. And she recalls once how she had gone to the police station to investigate a case. And a male colleague asked her, why have you come here? You could have taken information from me. So Reshma hit back angrily and said, do you think I'm incapable of doing anything that you are doing? So don't dare question my abilities again. And she said, you know, proudly told me that I have a strong network of sources. Sometimes I rush to the spot or simply call up the local police station or the DSP. So so she feels, she told me a very interesting thing, that the problems of women begin and end at home. A woman is most exploited at home. If she finds support at home, she can do wonders. Somehow I can hear echo. Am I echoing?
No, no, you are not for me.
I'm not. Okay. No. So, welcome to yet another edition of Thumbprint Conversation, and we are discussing why women write. And we have with us Mitra Phukan, who needs no introduction, actually. She is a writer, translator, and columnist. Her published works include 4 children's books, a biography, 2 novels, The Collector's Wife, and A Monsoon of Music. Her most recent works are a collection of her own short stories, A Full Night's Thievery, and another translated book, Agoni Bai, and other stories. Her works have been translated into many languages, and several are taught in colleges and universities. Her column, All Things Considered, in the Assam Tribune, is widely read. And in fact, someone had messaged me that some PhD scholars of Cotton University are interested in this conversation, and they are going to take, they'll be participating.
How wonderful. So, I look forward, Teresa, and it's such a change in these lockdown days.
Yes. So Mitra Bhatta, since we are talking about why women write, so
right.
please tell us, why do you think women write or do not write? And why do you write?
See, it's not a simple question of, you know, women just
yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
It's not just a simple question of, you know, women writing just like men do. No, there's a lot of dynamics happening here. As you said about your journalist friends, it's the same thing, unfortunately, about writers as well. And as we know, you know, the woman's voice has been suppressed. And women's, people may sneer when I say it, but it's true. And it's not given the weight that it should be. And, you know, women's, the concerns, they are very dismissed. They're very dismissive that, oh, this is woman's work and all that. And this is just the domestic sphere. What do you mean, just the domestic sphere? It is, in that case, you would say that Jane Austen is also domestic sphere. So that of course is not at all relevant. And you know what happens also in our country, because the literacy rate as it is low, and then when it comes to a choice, then the girl child is not given education. How will she write? She will not write. And then even if she, I think every woman to do, whether you are doing, everybody has some creativity within them. And in whatever form it is, some people, if you notice, if they are illiterate in their villages, they do these beautiful alponas and all, because they are illiterate, but they have to express themselves. So women writing, first of all, you have to be literate. You have to have your own space. You have to have that dignity. That it's good. I mean, it's not, the people around you should not be dismissive that what is this, is just scribbling and so on. I know, and I have heard of so many very important writers who would write after, say, 12 or getting up at 4 in the morning before the morning duties began, so that they could write at least a page, at least a poem. So yes, women write because they have to, they must. It's a form of creativity. It's a way of making, for me, writing is a way of making sense of the world around me. It is a way of expressing myself. It is my way of expressing dissent in my own way. Dissent because I cannot go and shout it out in, you know, rallies and political things. But as far as I am able, that is my way of dissent. And that is my way of agreeing. That is my way of creating. So I find that many, and you know, when this topic was brought out, many people said, oh, what's the difference between a man writing and a woman writing? There's a huge difference. It is an act of rebelliousness in a way. And I'm not speaking for myself in this, because I am empowered. People like me, people like us, as they say, we are privileged. We have got good education. We have had the same opportunities as our brothers, as our nephews and all that. But there are many who do not, and we must recognize that. And we must recognize that when a woman from a village who has maybe got into class 10 or got into class 12 or just making it into college, when she writes a short story, that is a very, very precious thing, because she has stolen time from her daily, the duties that she has to do. She has stolen that education. She's making use of it. So yes, women writing is a very different thing from men writing, even today.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that.
And I feel, even if she writes a lullaby or
right.
maybe just
maybe
a speech,
just
a public speech,
a public
you know,
speech, you know?
That itself is an expression of creativity.
Yes, and another thing I would like to add here is that, you know, the alternate story, women, because if you look at our mythologies, the Hindu mythologies, the Hindu epics and so on, it is always the man's point of view. It is heroic, it is valor, it is war, it is, you know, high principles and all. The women are there, but they are subsidiary characters. Now, for instance, Draupadi, I always wonder how did she feel? Because she loved Arjun, and Arjun won her with his prowess. But she came home and she found that she would have to share her bed with five of them. And now, of course, there are people who are writing from her point of view. Yagna Seni, there's that beautiful book. So that thing. And so it's that alternate that, no, it is history or epics cannot be written only by men. They have been written by men so far. But now it is time that women put things in perspective, and women are characters there. But their real, you know, their inner workings, what it could have been, what it may have been, those are never highlighted. So, and in fact, once in one of my stories, you know, there's a very famous song by the icon Bhupen Hazarika, where he describes the woman has left the boy for another man, and the boy is singing that, oh, you left me because, you know, you went to somebody who was richer. So I thought, why should the woman be made the villain of the piece? She may have an alternate story. She may have a different take or perspective. So I wrote my song, Spring Song, in which I deal with this. Now, I don't think a man could have done that. A man, it would never have occurred to him. But as a woman, it did occur to me. So these are the reasons, I think, a few of the reasons why women write. You were saying something, Teresa?
Yeah. In fact, you know, there is this debate among writers and intellectuals here in Assam that writing in English is elitist.
Yes.
And the, and you know, the dichotomy between writing about rural and urban realities. We tend to ignore the fact that urban realities are very much a fact of life. So yes. So how do you try to address these realities through your writings?
Actually, this is a subject that is very dear to me, and I have been speaking about it all over the country, in fact. And, you know, when I began to write long, long, long ago, my columns in Sentinel, which was City Chirpings and all those middles, which the editor very kindly, you know, encouraged me to write, Thayan Bezborua. So at that time, and I was just feeling my way and writing short stories and children's stories. I was writing stories for Femina and all that. Then, actually, they were well-meaning people. I don't blame them. They said, why are you writing in English? If you are going to be a, seriously, if you're going to write, write in Assamese. Who will read your works? Who will read if you are writing in English? So I said, see, we don't choose the language that we are going to write in. The language, in a way, chooses us. And I think we write in the language which was our medium of instruction. So I was educated in India as well as outside. So I was obviously educated in English. And that I always say, English is my first language, but Assamese is my home language. It is my mother tongue. It's not a question of, you know, this weight, that weight. My mother tongue is my mother tongue. It's very dear to me. And we use our different languages in different contexts. For instance, Assamese, I would use in so many contexts. In Guwahati, I'm using mostly Assamese. But when I write original work, then I am writing in English. And when I'm translating from Assamese, it is always into English. Then similarly, I use Hindi, but that is with my, you know, friends I have who are more comfortable in Hindi. Of course, I use Hindi with them. And Bangla, I love Bangla. And I try to speak it as much as possible whenever I get a chance. So we use these languages in different contexts. But so when I began to write in English, and they said it's very elitist, but that's not the case. I am writing always about Assam, always, and somehow I come back to Assam, somehow I come back to, and this was pointed out to me actually, I didn't realize it, that somehow the river, Brahmaputra River, always makes itself felt in some way in all my stories, which I hadn't realized myself. So it is about Assam, and the language in any case is just a medium. And when I speak about this at, you know, other forums around the country, people are very surprised that, are you still fighting that battle? I said, yeah, we are still fighting that battle. So that is a sad thing, but the good thing is that now there are so many writers in English, because I was, for fiction, I was one of the first. Sanjoy was there, who had done, you know, his beautiful book, Strangers of the Mist, before me, but that was non-fiction. So now there are so many people writing from Assam, very, very, very books in English, including you, Teresa. I would like to say that I really loved both your books, Bulletproof, of course, is your latest. And I found that so many of the stories that, I mean, you know, the chapters that you have, they make for very good short stories. In fact, they're short stories, I would say. I look at you, of course, especially, you know, when you went to a restaurant to meet that militant, and he came and you're describing your fears, and how that is a short story, I thought. And and if I didn't know you so well, I might have pinched that idea also, but now I can't. But it's really beautiful.
Thank you so much. You so in fact, after writing that chapter, I actually sat and wondered, did it really happen to me?
I know, I had to pay.
Yeah,
I understand. And a lot of what you wrote there, it seems unreal. It seems like fiction. You know, I write fiction, of course. But for me also, you know, this observation for fiction, for poetry, everything, you have to have this sense of observation. And for me, and I know for many people also, it is observation from life, it is also from reportage. You hear about something happening, or you read about something happening, and it sticks in your mind so much that you have, for instance, in my Collector's Wife, there was this police officer who was he was in a Chinese restaurant, and he was having an anniversary dinner there, and he was shot. And I have put that into my book, because there was no way I couldn't put it into my book, because it was bugging me all the time, you know, how can this happen, how can this happen. So that was the thing. And I would like to say also about, you know, women writing and so on, is when I wrote The Collector's Wife, in fact, I got a lot of, not criticism, but a lot of questions from Assam, that why are you writing from this point of view? Because I wrote from the victim's point of view. I did not glorify insurgency. I wrote about the victims, and I wrote about a woman victim. So that is also the, and I that caught me, you know, because I saw so many women victims all around me. Who were, I mean, they were not the ones who were kidnapped, they were not the ones who were extorted for money, but they were the ones who sat in their house and just went mad trying to figure out what is happening to their sons, what is happening to their husbands, and so on. So that's the view I wanted to give.
Apparently you have to be a little louder.
Oh, is
that's
it?
What one, I think Meenakshi Borkar, she
is it okay now, Meenakshi, is it better? Can you hear me now, Meenakshi?
So since you had mentioned that a prolific breed of writers in English have emerged from India's northeast.
Right.
So how do you see this trend?
How would you assess the quality of these writings?
Most of it, actually nowadays, writings from the Northeast, whether in translation or original writing, is, I would say, the flavor of the times. Everybody wants to have a piece of what is happening. And I think that is because of the, can you hear me?
Yeah.
I can hear you.
I wonder if Meenakshi can hear me.
You keep
Anyway,
talking
keep
so that
talking so that
okay. The thing is that for a long time translations were not, I'm talking of Assam and also to an extent Manipur, which also has a very rich written literature. For a long time translations were not available. Nowadays translation, very good translations are being done. And in the other states, the hill states, where English, in some, English is a very dominant language. Many people write in English. They have been educated in English, so they are writing in English. So that kind of writing, and you know, a lot of the writing that is coming out from the hills, especially the of this region, the northeast, they are a different kind of. They are not. They are. They can be urban, but they also have. They are very rooted in the land, you know. For instance, Mamang's. Mamang's works, their land of mist, land of the dawn-lit mountains. Janice's work, at least the first one, Boats on Land, where it's very evocative. All these are very evocative. And as far as Assam is concerned, we have a lot of, like, for instance, Dhruba Hazarika, of course, though he is more my generation. And younger people who are writing very well and more urban stuff, because if you're writing in English, obviously, you know, you are more urban than rural. But that does not make them less relevant, I would like to say. And there's Ankush Saikia, who is writing very good thrillers. I mean, you can hardly keep them down. So these are, and the language is being used absolutely, you know, they are being molded. That's another important thing. The English language, as it is used by writers from this region, because this is the first generation, the second generation, it is being molded. It is being made to give the meanings of, you know, for instance, if I write about Bihu, which has not been written about previously. So how to bring that into my story without breaking the narrative or giving footnotes and all that. So these are the challenges that we work with when we work in English. It's from a different culture, but it is also our first language. So therefore, I think these are beautiful things that are happening all around me. And when I read a new writer writing in English, I learn a lot. This is how she is using the language. This is how she is molding the language to suit her story, to suit her culture.
You know, and a lot of non-fiction
is also
being written.
Right.
And you
and
also
you
wrote
also
a piece
wrote a
in the
piece in
book,
the
Insider,
book.
Outsider.
Insider, Outsider.
Yeah.
So
Could you tell us something,
tell
about,
us something
it?
About it?
Yeah, I don't have the book here right now. But, but, I mean, it's in my other room. But yes, Insider, Outsider, you know, it was about, it's an anthology. And they said the brief was that you write basically about this region. So everybody wrote from their perspective, and there's a huge variety, a wide variety. It was edited by Samrat Chaudhary, Samrat X, and Preeti Gill, who are both, you know, they know this region inside out. So how is it that somebody who has lived in this region for so many generations is considered to be an outsider, and vice versa. Somebody who comes in from outside, I mean, is considered an outsider, but when you go out to Delhi, for instance, then you are considered an outsider. So where are you an insider in this country? Where are you? And you know, I think in fiction, okay? So I think in stories. So I wrote a piece which is not exactly fiction, which is not exactly non-fiction. It's an essay. I took a person I knew who had migrated from East Bengal long ago when he was a very young man. Then he came to Shillong and kind of settled there. Not lower middle class, you know, but he was kind of happy. And then, of course, there were all this. He had to leave Shillong because he was made to leave Shillong because of the riots there and so on. And then his son was working, his daughter was in Calcutta. And even though the language was the same, it was not the language of East Bengal, which he knew, Bangladesh at that time, later on. So how that person constantly was always an outsider. So that was, and it was, it I it was the story of a real person, but I kind of made it more palatable or more readable or something instead of Harry. But it was, I wrote it with a lot of tears in my heart. So those are, and also I write a lot about translation, you know, even though I am not an academic, and the editors who ask me to write about translation, about the theories of translation, they know that I'm not an academic, but so I write from experience, and that is also, you know, that settles my brain kind of. I know then that okay, this is why I'm doing it. This is, I mean, because for me, translation is an intuitive kind of a thing. I know this language. I know what he means. I know what the author is trying to say, and this is the language I am trying to put it into. So that is the for me it is intuitive, and often, you know, I try to work with writers who I'm translating who are alive, or so that I can go back to them again and again, or barring that, somebody who is very close to them. So for instance, Biren Bhattacharjee's work Kobbor Aru Phool, which I translated, I was requested to do that, and I was very happy to do it. He's of course no more, but I was in constant touch with his wife, who gave me a lot of, and she would say that, you know, oh, he was thinking of this when he wrote this. He used this word, and this is the, because when some words are brought into Assamese, they tend to change, and when you put it into English, you cannot use that. So those are the challenges, and those are the things that I have been doing in the non-fiction domain.
So let us
Closer
Mitra
to the
Phukan, you know.
writer Mitra
So
Phukan, you know. Yeah.
when do
So
you write?
when do you
Do you
write?
need to be
Do you need
alone
to be
when you
alone when you
write?
write?
You need
You need
isolation,
isolation,
or
or
tell us
tell
something
us
about,
something about, you know.
See, writing is something that you have to do on your own, okay? You have to sit down somewhere. Either when I first began writing all those years ago, it was with a pencil, I mean a pen and paper, and I would sit on the bed, which I was always very comfortable with, and I would write down a middle, and then I would actually type it out. Then I got the computer, which my father gave me. I think as soon as it was available, he gave me the computer, and so I began to do that. So it is, previously when my children were small, and you know, the house was buzzing with activity, and there were people coming and going, then I would, in a way, snatch time. My pieces then were much shorter, you know, and it's not that I was unhappy. I was very happy because I was also trying to find my feet. But gradually now, I have a set time. Yes, I write from about 7:38 at night, and I've always, you know, from Monday to Friday I write, and I give myself off on Saturday, on Sunday, on the principle that, you know, if I was working in an office, I would get an off anyway. But that doesn't mean that I don't. A writer's mind is constantly working, constantly. So if I go somewhere and I find something, I still have this habit of, you know, making a note on a piece of paper or something. But I know other writers who do it on their phone. They immediately make a note, because you tend to, that you have to catch that thought, that elusive thought, and you know, and then work on it. It's like what shall I say? You have to marinate that thought. It's a cooking metaphor. So that thought must be there, and then it must, you can't, it won't come out immediately in a story. You have to flesh it out and all. So all of that, but then of course it's slog. It is slog. From 7:38 till about 11:30, 12. And I wander around, I have my dinner, I go, and then I, you know, think of some more and all that. But I have a set number of words. sometimes it comes very easily, and 2 hours, 2.5 hours it comes. Sometimes I have to write till 1 o'clock, 1:30, because it's so difficult. So I find that for me, what works for me is having a set number of words rather than hours. That's how I do it. And I often work on 2 or 3 projects. When I find I'm stuck in my fiction, then I go to the translation. And when I'm stuck in my, or when I'm, you know, fed up of translation, then I go to an essay. And of course, my columns give me a lot of joy, but, you know, they're small pieces, but they give me a lot of joy.
Mm-hmm.
So that is what I do. Other people also have their own ways of doing it. It's a very personal thing.
Mm-hmm. And how easy was this?
I would like to ask you, when you were in the field and you were, you know, going to all these places and all, at what point did you write? You came back and wrote, or you scribbled the notes there? You had your laptop with you?
I used to always carry my notebook
right.
And my pen,
and my
because,
pen.
I was not very tech savvy.
So
I used to come back.
I'm like a typical journalist. I work best when I'm working against a deadline.
When I'm racing against a deadline.
So
if you tell me that
I want this piece
on this day
after 1 month,
so maybe on the
last day
I'll
sit and do it.
I can't go.
I said,
don't give me such
a long deadline.
And,
for us journalists, we
people say that,
people say
what is your deadline?
What is your deadline? We say it's yesterday.
Of course.
I like to work, I like noisy places, I'm not very comfortable being lonely, so I'm a typical journalist.
Okay. No, that's the thing. Even though writers write alone, the process of writing, for me, I need people around me. Otherwise, where will I get my ideas from? Something is happening, something is said, I need people. And right now I am dying to go to the crowd. Of course, it's locked now. But, you know, phasi ho ja and just be part of that crowd. I want that.
I'm missing Guwahati, but I'm missing the sights and sounds of Guwahati.
Yeah, how long can one stay? And you go out and with, you know, I'm so happy about this. I don't know if I could say it's wearing kajal after 2 months. So that is the thing. And another thing I wanted to ask you, Teresa, you were working for these mainstream newspapers.
Mm-hmm.
Now you are doing your Thumbprint, which is an online journal. Was that transition difficult? What made you do that?
Actually, when people ask me why did you start the Thumbprint?
Yeah.
I often say that it's a very angry reaction.
To?
After I had quit Tehelka.
Right.
Is my voice echoing?
Not for me.
Okay.
So after I had quit Tehelka, I thought I would write independently for various media houses, so-called mainstream national media.
But when I had to struggle to find space for my stories, I refused to beg for space. I said, I'm going to create my own space.
Right.
And this is where I discovered the might of the internet.
Thumbprint is like a cottage industry.
I sit in my living room in a small town in Assam.
And we're actually being brave in calling ourselves an international magazine.
With a Northeastern soul.
So that's probably true because you have readers everywhere, and you also write stories about other places.
So it's like I had no choice as a journalist.
When you are not based in
Yeah, you were not willing to compromise.
Some big metro.
I wanted to create my own space. And I realized that, you know, there is a hunger for news and views from stories from the region.
Because this is a region which is a paradise for journalists.
There are many stories waiting to be told. Actually, there's an echo in my voice. Even I can hear the echo. Some people are saying, I don't know how to sort this.
I don't know how to do. No, I think there's a problem with my voice. Oh, okay.
It's echoing.
But for me, I'm not hearing any echo. So, trying new tricks to survive and retain our sanity.
Like the live shows we're doing now.
Because we thought that we have to survive with what we have and make the best of what we have.
Like I used to do media analysis for the Hoot website.
Then I used to do climate change stories for Reuters.
I used to look for specialized portals where I could write about stories from the Northeast. So I think maybe just my geographical position, location. In fact, one senior journalist had told me. Teresa, your location is your disadvantage. So I said that I'm going to make it my plus point. And I'm not going to give up and I'm not going to complain. You know, the usual moaning that goes on that North is not adequately represented. Victimhood. I refuse to give my thing to that idea. So I thought, let me do something different and try to make the best of what we have.
Yeah, so there's an echo in my voice.
Maybe if I can take out this headphone and the earplugs.
So, is there an echo now? Now you're very faint.
I'm very faint, but I think there's still an echo.
So I'd rather put on this earplugs. Now you're clearer. Yeah, you'll be clearer now.
So I think you do the talking. I'm echoing.
Anyway, I'm talking so much.
So would you like to read out something?
So this is show us your books. We want to see your books. I have 11.
Okay, show us, please.
These are short stories. Preeti, who was my editor and who is now a very good friend. And she's my agent as well now. So she had asked a bunch of, and there's a very nice backstory about this, which I will not say now. She asked a bunch of her friends and also other women writers to write stories of murder. And these are women who have never written of murder before. But of course, I don't know about the others, but I always read. I can't leave murder stories. Just now, in fact, just the other day, I finished one called Death in the East by Abir Mukherjee. That's really good. I'm recommending it to all of you. It's really good. So anyway, I wrote this and I really enjoyed it. And I'll read out a little bit from the beginning. The story is about a murder that takes place in front of a hall full of people. It is a woman, a singer. And the name of the story is Poison in the Pan. And I'm not giving anything away because pan is just the means. Who does it? Who done it? That is the main thing. So I'll just read out. So this is, you know, she's getting into her act and all. And my detective, who is not at all musically inclined, but her partner is, you know, he's an aficionado of music. So she's there. So she's addressing her remarks to the chief guest with whom she's flirting. Come, Chaudhary Sahab, this is for you, she said. Smiling, she began a taan, a silvery succession of notes that climbed up the scale like an eagle soaring into the blue sky above. Her hand, expressive as her voice, drew arcs that spiraled up, echoing the music. But the unthinkable, halfway up that taan, Shraddha Devi began to cough. On stage, all eyes swiveled towards her. This was something that should not happen even to a beginner. How could? The hall full of people sat up, all of them aware suddenly of something gone awry. A top Thumri singer, her taan cut off mid-flow by a cough. Indeed, it was getting worse by the second. The hand that was executing visual music changed course and clutched at her throat instead. Her face was now flushed, contorted. As they watched, a look of fear, of panic, suffused it. Her eyes watered and began to pop out. A horrible choking sound came from her, the total antithesis of the music of just a few seconds before, as, before their very eyes, she keeled over sideways. She was gasping for breath now, choking and sputtering. The musicians, on auto mode, kept playing, even as they looked at her with increasing horror. The audience had not yet grasped what was happening as they stared, astonished at the drama before them. And then she dies in front of everybody. So that's the beginning of the story. That's the,
so the,
you know,
pan,
just,
yeah. Pan is very
pan
interesting.
Is very interesting.
And all the stories are lovely. All of them are,
yeah.
You know, whodunits.
Yeah.
And this is the can I read a bit of that story I told you about where
it was
a response. So this is the story. The story everybody, every Assamese knows, Khoi Khobote Dhemalite, which I have used it as the base. You left me for another. This is the man singing, the person who she has left behind. Leaving behind the monarch of your heart, you went with the prince of wealth, chanting of riches you left, shaped by the love of wealth in that storm. This story is in the first person also. So, how many times in the past had I heard you singing just this song? How many times had I been moved by the lines? But last night, they seemed to be imbued with a special significance. I could see people looking at me as you sang those lines. Suddenly, it had dawned on me. To all those people who knew me on the lawn and were looking out of the sides of their eyes at me, and most important, to you, I had been, I am, a betrayer. The song that you were even then singing paralleled in their eyes our lives 15 years ago. No doubt for you too, the song had become the story of our lives. Yes, I realize, I need to explain. To you, and also to myself, not because I feel guilty or anything like that, you understand. But seeing you and others think of me as a betrayer, I feel the need to revisit the past. You may think and persuade yourself that I had betrayed you. It is probably easier for you to believe that of me, but you know deep down that it wasn't really like that, don't you? So that's how she goes back to the past, and then she explains that, no, I mean, I grew, you didn't. And you can fall out of love, and I did. So that was my response to that song, which was also a little shocking for some people because it was a Bhupen Hazarika song, which I love very much. I love it very much. How can you not? But it's a little unfair to the woman, I thought. So that is also one reason why I write, to say that, no, it can't be just the man's point of view. It has to be, you have to bring in the woman as well. So that was the thing.
Meenakshi
Borkakuti
has a question.
Yeah.
How much do you
need to
read
in order to write?
And how does
your
musical training help you in your writing.
Please tell us about
your
musical
innings.
Yeah,
as
actually,
well.
You know, for the first so many decades of my life, music was what I did. Okay, writing was just, you know, middles and so on. Music was what I did. Music was, and I was a professional radio artist. I was singing in concerts all over, and it was my life. But then there's something that changed in my life. Something happened, and I still love music, but I never perform in public. But the other thing is that now I write extensively about music, you know, reviews and so on. So are that pleasure still there? There's always music. So Meenakshi, yes, thank you for the question. And musical training, I feel how it has helped me is that it has given me, especially Shastriya Sangeet, where you have to get up. It's rigid. You have to get up and do riyaz for however many hours. That discipline it has taught me. That I must, as I said, I write this many words. Just as I have to keep repeating that tan till I get it. So in that way, I have to keep doing it. I have to write this many words. I have to keep polishing it, editing it myself, self-editing. That I think has been a really very valuable life lesson for me. And it is there for my writing as well. And the other thing, how much do you have to read? I am a very avid reader. Books have been my companion because my father was moving from place to place, and I would always pre-net days, and I would always you know, leave friends behind and have to make new friends. But the books were the constant companions. There were always books in the house. My parents were also readers. So yes, I am an avid reader. But you know, Meenakshi, I think that more than reading, it so happens I'm a reader, and my discipline, postgraduate in English literature, because I'm a reader. But the thing is that firstly, I had to forget all the reading that I did. I had to find my own voice. I had to write about stories that nobody had written about before. I had to create characters that nobody had created before. And for that, it is the imagination is not enough. For that, the book is not enough. For me, I don't know, it may be different for, I'm only talking about myself. For me, I have to meet people. I have to know their stories. I have to know what Teresa has gone through in order to write that story, that real life story. I have to know what journalists are saying. I have to know what people are saying today when I go to the shops and I listen to them. So for me, that is the trigger. And the other very, very, you know, once I was somewhere at a lit fest or something, and I overheard two people talking about somebody else's book. And they said, oh, it's very apparent that she's an English literature person, because her style is totally English. And since then I have been in fear. I hope nobody calls me an English person. And in my stories, it should not be apparent that I, you know, my academic qualifications are English literature. Though, of course, they have enriched me greatly. Mm-hmm. So, Meenakshi, I think it has to be a balance of both, because what we can do is that find out what somebody is doing to the language, for instance, English language, or what somebody is doing. And of course, I try to read as much as possible in Assamese. I try to, and that is one of the reasons I'm doing translations, so that what are the writers of my land doing? What are the writers of my land talking about? How are they constructing their plots, their characters? Then, you know, reading a plot. But that is a personal thing. For me, I have to go out and meet people and read their minds, read what they are saying. I hope that answers your question.
Reading minds, so that is. I think the mantra. Yeah.
Yeah.
To bring out something original.
You spoke about Litfest,
and you were also part of the
Writers Forum.
Northeast Writers
Northeast
Forum.
Writers
Can you tell
Forum.
Us how
Can you tell
do
us
these
how
forums
do these forums
help in nurturing
help
young
in
writers?
Nurturing young writers?
Yeah, yeah. Actually, the Northeast Writers Forum began many years ago when all of us were, you know, still kind of finding our feet. And of course, a writer is always finding her feet, but still, you know, we were not really published authors in that sense. And it was a getting together because at that point, there were very few of us. We were kind of writing in isolation and not really knowing what was happening. And it, so a group of us got together. Meenakshi was one of them. Dhruva Hajarika was one of the moving spirits. Dhiren Besbora did a lot to put the whole thing on its feet. In the beginning, we would have them in Meenakshi's house and we would have readings where we would kind of, you know, kind of, for me, it was taking inspiration. I remember Mamang would read out bits of her, what she was writing, which later became Legends of Pensum. And I am always very shy about reading my work, very shy. It's like, I don't know, finding myself, I mean, when it is printed and it's out of my sight, that's okay. But, you know, when it is a work in progress, I just can't read it out. So I would listen and get ideas and get encouragement. The main thing was that, you know, it was just because we were together, it was encouraging us. So that's, and now of course it has grown, there's the second generation as well. And the main thing is that it is Northeast writers, 8 states. That I was told that 8 states getting together to form one literary forum is very, very unusual. And that's because we are writers who write in English. Primarily, we may also be writing in our own mother tongues, but primarily we are writing in English. Published, it doesn't matter. I, for one, I don't look at the quality. Who am I to judge quality? I mean, my poison may be your meat and so on. But that's the thing, and it's really, it's a lot of, you know, fellowship and friendship and encouragement and so on. As for litfests, yes, I enjoy being invited. I go as far as possible if it doesn't clash with, sometimes very sadly 2 or 3 invitations clash, then I can't go. But I love going to Litfest and saying my piece because I'm there as a speaker. And so I'm taken very good care of. I'm hosted very well. I can say my piece. I, from the audience, people can ask me questions and, you know, I can explain what it is. And more than that, I can listen to others. I can listen. And when I interact in the author's lounge and so on, I have met so many of the writers whom I really admire. When I meet them, I can, you know, say that I really like this, but why did you, why was it like, what were you thinking and all? So I love it. I love it. And I love it when you know, readers come up and they say that, you know, I have read this book of yours and I liked this, or I liked the, I, many people come to me with, you know, the collector's wife and they say, we love the book, but we were so sad about the ending. I said, no, but that's the only way it could have ended. And so they are. And this question is always there. Do you like the smaller ones or the bigger ones? Litfest, I like both. Each one has its own dynamics. The Jaipur Litfest, I've been invited several times. And I loved the dynamics of that. A huge affair, but very, very well organized. And we are allotted somebody to look after us all the time. So it's really been good. And I have met so many writers, listened to so many writers whom I would not have had otherwise, you know, of all kinds of genres. And of course, the very small ones also, I love. For instance, before this lockdown began, in I think in November or December, there was this little ukiyo festival in Imphal, it's a little bookshop, and they invited us, and it was so sweet the way they went out of their way to make us comfortable and all. And I felt as though it was my kind of, not even children, grandchildren who were doing that. It was really nice. And then there was one in Zero, which was also a new, because everybody knows about the Zero Music Festival, but this is a new thing that's coming up. That's the Zero Lit Fest. And I was very happy to be part of that and to speak what I could about it.
So, have you done any lockdown writing?
Oh, lots.
Okay.
Doing it all the time. Yeah. Because they have been, as you said, internet is the force these days, and it's probably what's keeping us sane and together. So I have been asked by several, you yourself, for Thumbprint I wrote, and other people have also been writing. There is this writer who is editing a book of 50 pieces by 50 writers worldwide. I am one of them. About, you know, thoughts as I go into 50 days, 60 days of lockdown, what are my thoughts? And these are not very long pieces. And then, you know, I see people reacting to the lockdown in various ways. In my neighborhood, there was a huge marital fight, a domestic fight, which I heard. They were not aware that, you know, they could be heard. So I am weaving a story around that, because they're very, I know they're very decent and polite people, but you hear of, you know, marital violence and so on. So that is something that, that has been bugging me. I'm doing that. And then I have been asked to write about non-lockdown issues also, which are pending. And of course, then my normal writing, whatever I am doing. So yes, that part of me is always busy, but I wish I could go out and, you know, really meet people.
So, you had joined us once in the blind school. We had an interfaith iftar.
Yes, that was about 2 years ago. That was also very wonderful.
And we are ready. We can take readers' questions.
Anyone has any queries for?
Meanwhile, you can.
Would you mind telling us about curating a book on Assamese writers in translation?
Right. So that is also a project. That's also a project from a very well-known publishing house. So it's writings which I have chosen. Basically, these things are all personal, you know. But also I have chosen stories that resonate or have resonated with readers throughout, you know, through decades or maybe even. So I began with Lokhinath Bezborua, one of his stories, and then because he's supposed to be the father of the short stories and so on, and then I have come down to absolutely one of my favorite writers at this point, Orupa Patangia Kolita, beautiful stories she writes. And of course, Hare Krishna Dekha, whom I have translated extensively. And Purobi Bormudoy, who has written so beautifully. The story is called, I've called it The Hunt. And it's about Mrigoya. It's about how you know, a group of men are drinking and hunting a deer. So these, and of course, Bhoben Khoikia and so on. And I have asked other people also to send in that. Of course, Indira, one of her best known icon, the one I like most, Honskar, about this woman who, it's a very well-known story. So Honskar and I have asked other translators to send in, you know, work on these, and I've sent it now to the publisher. So we are working on the editing. So the editing is going on. It's always a slow process, but it's fine. I've signed the contract. So these are the things, you know, if I write or I translate or I'm doing this, there's always a little bit of variety in my work. But I wish there would be more variety in my life right now.
Shantanu Kukan sir has said the eco continues. We are trying to echo the voices of many women who are not heard.
So, technology is playing pranks with us.
I don't know how to handle this. And yes, Meenakshi Borkhakutty says,
you are absolutely clear. For me, you are absolutely clear.
Really?
Okay.
So Meenakshi Borkhakutty says that I hope you carry on these conversations. In fact, we are having back-to-back conversations tomorrow. I'm having a conversation with Swati Bhattacharji, a very senior journalist with Ananda Bhojan Patrika. And she has co-authored a book with
Abhijit Banerjee.
Tomorrow we'll be having a conversation with Swati.
Do join us tomorrow again.
And we can wait for another few minutes. If readers have any queries for us. The viewers, readers. Would you like to end with a reading?
Yes. Since everybody...
It's the same time. It's 9 p.m. tomorrow.
This is another anthology that I wrote for An Unsuitable Woman, where I wrote about this lady who is part of our, you know, she the Mohila Committee, she had started it. But I will end with somebody always wants me to, people always want something from the collector's wife. I'll just read a bit. This is when just after the police officer whom I spoke about, which is a true story, he was my neighbor, in fact. So when after he's killed, then Rukmini, her husband is of course the collector, he goes and she says, no, I will also go with you because I know the wife. I just met her in the afternoon. I'll just read a bit. Nandini Deori and her three children were sitting around a table, still piled with noodles, chili chicken and sweet and sour prawns. Nobody had cleared away the table after the killing. Splotches of what looked like tomato sauce, but which Rukmini realized after a sickened moment must be Deori's blood, lay on the table, a chair, and the floor. A cluster of policemen stood at one end of the room, gathered around a large, lumpy shape under a sheet. Deori's body, Rukmini realized with a shock. A large red Chinese fan stood watch on the wall above the body, while a dainty wooden double dragon, mobile, rotated peacefully, fluttering over his body in the slipstream of the breeze stirred up by the fan. Impulsively, Rukmini went forward and held Nandini's hands. At her touch, Nandini's eyes filled with tears. She began to sob. The children, taking their cue from their mother, also began to cry. With the tears came the words, broken, disoriented, still uncomprehending of the full magnitude of what had happened. Death was all around them in Parbatpuri, but until it struck home, it remained a distant thing, something that would never enter their lives, at least in the foreseeable future. Rukmini, stroking Nandini's anguished hands, tried to calm her, but the words came out in tumbling gasps. She had to talk so that she could begin to understand, so that she could try to make sense of the senseless thing that had happened right there in front of her. So sudden, we were laughing, we were just beginning to eat. Deori was sitting there just opposite the door that leads outside. He seemed to see something. I mean, he stopped laughing and his eyes, they became frightened. I turned around, but I could only see a hand with a gun coming out from the door. I saw a finger press on the trigger. Yes, I saw it distinctly. There was a terrible sound. When I looked back again, Deori wasn't anywhere. He was on the floor. He didn't even speak. He looked at me, but I think, oh God, what's happened? What? She broke down completely. The children began to wail. Their mother looked up at Rukmini with a tear-stained, convulsed face and said, it was our anniversary, you know, our 15th wedding. She let go of Rukmini's hands and gathered her children close to her. And the thing is that it is true, this did happen. So, and somebody like you.
Yeah, it was lovely.
It was lovely.
talking to you, and I can still hear my voice echo.
Anyway, this was really nice. Yeah, thank you so much, Teresa, for this opportunity of speaking after a long time. Thank you.
And actually, there are some questions about how much time do you devote to your creative writing by Ruksana Rahman Khan. So I think you have answered these questions.
Yeah, I've answered. So this video will be available on my YouTube channel.
So you can subscribe to the channel and listen to this interview again, and send your feedback, and keep reading Mitra Phukan.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's been wonderful. Good night. We'll see you again tomorrow. Yes, I have been following in any case, though not live, later on. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Have a good night.
You too.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.